Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to extend a very warm welcome to all our participants, dignitaries, and our highly esteemed speakers to the online seminar on Commodity Market Fundamentals Forum, Energy and Agriculture, organized by the IMC Chamber of Commerce and Industry in association with MCX IPF. All participants will be muted to avoid any disturbances during the course of the session. To consume less bandwidth and have clarity, you may like to stop video streaming at your end. Kindly post your relevant queries and feedback in the chat section so that the same can be addressed during the Q&A session. As we begin, may I request Mr. Jusur Korakiwala, Vice President, IMC Chamber of Commerce and Industry, to present the welcome address. Over to you, Mr. Korakiwala.
Thank you. Good afternoon, panelists, and good afternoon, all the participants to IMC. It gives me immense pleasure to welcome each one of you to this interesting Commodity Market Fundamentals Forum, Energy and Agriculture, organized by IMC, Agriculture and Food Processing Committee and IMC Economic Research and Training Foundation in partnership with MCX IPF. IMC and MCX are conducting events jointly from time to time to deepen and widen the Indian commodity derivatives market. This market has a huge potential for growth as commodities touch our everyday life in some way or the other. Energy products and agricultural commodities are all assigned a weight in the price index. Prices of these commodities have a bearing on the rate of inflation. Importantly, as our economy integrates with the global economy through trade and investment route, our domestic commodity market is increasingly influenced by developments in the global marketplace. A sound understanding of the market fundamentals is necessary to be able to read the emerging market trends reasonably correctly and thereby make informed trading and investment decisions. Whether as a producer, as a processor, as an industrial consumer or trader, those with exposure to commodities have to constantly monitor the market. This is especially important for those who take forward trading positions. Therefore, market outlook or a view of the likely behavior of market becomes important. While several drivers impact the market, a study of the supply and demand fundamentals is key to have a clear view about the unfolding future. On behalf of IMC, I must compliment MCX, India's leading commodity exchange and rated among the top in the world, for partnering with IMC to discuss commodity market fundamentals. A special thanks to our friend, Mr. P.S. Reddy, MD and CEO of MCX. Mr. Reddy is no stranger to IMC. Thank you, Reddy Ji, for being part of this event. Mr. Reddy will deliver a special address today for the benefit of all participants. Friends, we have lined up excellent speakers with domain expertise, representing some of the well-known names in the industry. Their insights into the market dynamics are sure to benefit all participants. I would like to thank all the speakers for consenting to be part of this event. For those of you who are not introduced to IMC, I'll say a few words about IMC. Established in 1907 and having its headquarters in the heart of the city of Mumbai, the IMC Chamber of Commerce and Industry, as an apex chamber of commerce, trade and industry in the Western region, which is membership base of over 5,000 members and over 150 trade associations affiliated to it. Together, it represents and advocates interests of over 400,000 business and industry establishments across the country from diverse sectors of industry. It has 26 industry-specific committees of experts through which it provides policy inputs and recommendations at various levels of government and organizes activities where eminent business and government leaders engage with its members on a wide range of issues to create an environment for sustainable economic development. IMC hosts foreign delegations visiting India and provides a platform for interaction to expand business ties and address issues affecting growth of business between visiting country's environment and India for doing business. We have an ADR center with arbitration and mediation facilities, education and training services, IMC library, IMC's Young Leaders Forum and Dynamic Ladies Wing, and so on. Our state-of-the-art venues available for hire and for catering to various sizes and equipped with Wi-Fi and video conferencing facilities and have been made COVID protocol compliant. We are authorized by Government of India to provide issuance of Certificate of Origin for exporters, and this service has also been made available online with digital stamping and signing features. The theme of the chamber this year is Reboot, Reform, Research as a theme for this year, as these three factors are going to be critical and crucial for India and other economies globally reeling under the impact of pandemic. Once again, I welcome you all to this very interesting seminar, and I'm sure you will have some important messages to learn from. Thank you very much. Over to you, the panelists.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Korakiwala. Now, may I request Mr. P.S. Reddy, MD and CEO, MCX, to present the special address. Over to you, Mr. Reddy. You'll have to unmute yourself, sir.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you, Chandrasekhar ji. Thank you, Mr. Korakiwala and other panelists on the dais or on the virtual platform. I'm grateful to you for inviting me to deliver this address. While I am excited about this, but COVID pandemic has increased the distance among us as, and that is a very saddening feature of this. Nonetheless, we have to live with it and stay safe. And at the same time, we need to grow as we did in the past, in the pre-COVID era. At this point in time, as MCX, we have been able to come out of the pandemic, of the disruption caused by pandemic in terms of trading volumes and participation by the market participant, by the players, various stakeholders. As MCX, you are all aware, we have an energy vertical, we have a bullion vertical, and we have base metals and agricultural commodities. Of course, agri constitutes a very small portion of it. But where, whatever we do it, especially in the cotton, that we are a big player out there. And we are keen to grow that platform further. In terms of energy sector, we have energy platform. We have what you call natural gas and crude oil. And thanks to pandemic and negative pricing in crude oil, and you know, the contract has taken a backseat for the time being, because the volatility is to contain that kind of volatility, we had imposed high margins, and they are not restored back to the pre 20th April period. So that's the reason why it has been continuing languishing, but we will be able to restore that. Margins will be brought down so that it will be on par with the other exchanges world over. While I am on this topic, we have been having a very good futures exchange and a very quite modernized, and the participation is very good. But at the same time, we do not have what you call a vibrant spot markets. If you see, for most of the products, other than the ones which are where we have tie up with international markets, the spot prices are collected through polling, where we have some good amount of traders' names, and we call them and then ask them for prices and average it out and remove outliners, etc. I don't think that is the way going forward. We should be having the vibrant spot markets. And Mr. Chandrasekhar has been pointing it out on many occasions. We must have vibrant spot markets. And that is something which is missing, be that in agriculture or non-agriculture. We are on the same, across the spot markets, we don't have vibrant spot markets in that sense. And that in that sense, we have signed up an MOU with M Junction which is a major player in mining products. It's an auction platform which provides, and it's a company promoted by Tata Steel and SAIL, where they are doing a lot of auctions for iron ores, steel and coal, etc. And we want to begin our journey in starting a spot platform for coal. So it's a spot coal exchange. That's what we thought of doing it. So that is only a beginning, but as we go along, for most of the products, we would like to have an organized spot market where deliveries will happen, price formation will be very transparent, and many players where in the form of branding, extracting some premium, although the base quality is the same. And the people are demanding that extra premium because there's a lack of trust in various products that are available. Among the manufacturers, like as a consumer, I can't trust every product that is being sold in the market. So if something is branded at XYZ and ABC, probably I have a faith in that and I pay that extra premium, I'm taking. But going forward, as MCX, we would be guaranteeing the quality and quantity irrespective of what that brand is. So every player will get a very level playing field, and they will be glad to buy on the MCX platform, on the spot platform, anything that you want, that they want. I think that is something which we are eagerly looking at it. And we would like to be called, not only we would like to, our vision is not just make in India, but also trade in India and price in India. And we are working towards that. In that direction, we are also empaneling Indian bullion refineries to deliver their product on the exchange platform. And that will bring in much closer the MCX platform to the physical market players. Similarly, we are planning to do what you call lead, a base metal product where almost 80-90% of the lead is recycled lead, and recycled to bring it to the purity of the primary lead. So that is something which we are planning to do that, and work is on. Maybe in the next 2-3 months time, we will be out with our list of empanel brands. So today we are depending on, for all these products, especially for gold, we call it an LBMA approved gold refiners are permitted. For metals, we say LME approved brands are permitted. I think we should stand on our own. We should have our own products listed on the exchange platform. And Atmanirbhar Bharat is something which we are keen to pursue it, irrespective of the challenges that are there in the process. Yes, Chandrasekhar has referred, a lot of infrastructure hurdles have to be removed, regulations have to be streamlined, not just relating to our own exchanges, but on the physical market side also. And as we go along, when we face the challenges, we will deal with them. And I'm sure government will also positively respond to make it not only make in India, but trade in India and price in India. And with these words, once again, I thank IMC for giving me an opportunity to speak, and grateful to all of you. And I wish you a happy virtual webinar. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Reddy.
Thank you, Mr. Reddy. One second. Hold on. Mr. Reddy Garu, thank you very much. First one, that you've shared a piece of your mind. I think we are on the same page. There are two points which I want to make while you are here. One is, as you know, IMC is a SEBI accredited training institution. And we are the only chamber of commerce in India which is accredited by SEBI as a training institution in commodity derivatives. I'm sure you're aware of it. Number two, what is also important is spot market. I'm speaking on behalf of our vice president, Mr. Khurakiwala, and I'm sure he will support me in what I'm saying, that IMC and MCX can work together in conceptualizing and in supporting and in establishing spot markets for a number of commodities. We have our own domain expertise. We have a number of senior people in the chamber with fantastic domain expertise in the physical market and in the cash market. And therefore, we can leverage our mutual strength and we can work together. Of course, we'll do these webinars and seminars, but a very different kind of activity can be started in terms of starting spot markets is what I think. So thank you very much. Yeah. Sylvie.
Thank you, Mr. Reddy. Now may I welcome our moderator for the session, Mr. G. Chandrasekhar, Director, IMC ERTF and Economic Advisor, IMC Chamber of Commerce and Industry, to initiate the discussion. Over to you, sir, again.
Thank you, Selby. As always, a very charming anchor for the event. Thank you very much. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes.
Is my slide visible?
No, you'll have to share it, sir.
So what should I do?
Go to share screen, select the presentation, and share.
I can't find that share screen anywhere.
Below. Below. And the mute, stop videos, participants, polls.
Share screen. Okay, all right.
In that, you'll have to select the PPT.
Yeah. Is that okay?
Yes.
Okay, sir. All right. Now, friends, it's such a delight for me to moderate this event. This is not the first time or the last 2017, 18, 19. This is the fourth year MCX and IMC have done several events in the last 4 years. And this Commodity Market Fundamental Forum is a very, very popular event, which most participants actually look forward to. You may be surprised, you may be wondering why, what is the connection between crude oil market and agriculture commodity market? There's a big, big connection between crude oil and agriculture commodity market. I'll come to that. Before that, I want to share with participants a very favorite slide of mine. I'm so fond of this, talking about it. I can actually deliver a 1 hour lecture on this, but obviously I'm not going to do that. I'm going to very quickly capture. There are 7 major drivers of global commodity markets. The first one is economic growth. There is a strong positive correlation between economic growth and commodity consumption. And there are some commodities which are known as growth commodities. For example, crude oil is called a growth commodity. Copper is called a growth commodity. Cotton is called a growth commodity because their consumption rises along with economic growth. And therefore, there's a strong relationship with growth, economic growth and commodity consumption. That's the first proposition I want to make. And today, the kind of commodities that we are going to look into, which obviously is crude oil, it is cotton and it is palm oil. I'll also tell you the connection between palm oil and the crude oil market a little later. The second one is geopolitics. Geopolitics refers to a warlike situation, geopolitical instabilities in certain parts of the world. And particularly when the geopolitical development happens around the Middle East, which is a hub of crude oil production, then it immediately impacts the crude oil market. Therefore, we should be tracking economic growth. We should be tracking geopolitical developments because that will give a cue to how crude oil prices are likely to behave. Crude oil prices impact agriculture commodity production. If crude oil prices were to rise, the cost of production of agriculture commodities will go up, particularly in developed economies where you have mechanized agriculture, where you have high levels of processing, where energy is used for transportation, etc. High crude oil price also impacts the price of synthetic fertilizer, which is used and for which crude oil is the feedstock. Crude oil price also affects palm oil prices, for example, vegetable oil prices in general and palm oil price in particular, because palm oil is often used as a feedstock for making making biodiesel, which is blended with mineral oil diesel. And therefore, if crude oil prices rise, there'll be greater diversion of vegetable oil like palm oil for diesel, biodiesel purposes, and therefore palm oil prices also will rise. We know monetary policy of various central banks of the world have a big impact on commodity prices because of the interest rate and because of liquidity. And this year we have seen, for example, in the United States, the US Fed has dropped interest rates to near zero levels. They've also printed about $3 trillion and that's flooding the economy, which means near zero interest rate and a huge infusion of liquidity. And a part of this liquidity actually comes into commodity markets. And even there are times we have seen in this world when commodity bubble actually starts to create. But when the monetary policy is ultra accommodative, commodity prices tend to rise. Okay? Then therefore, you need to track monetary policy. Now, the fourth factor to track is currency. And of course, I don't have to tell you the impact of currency on commodity import and export. If the rupee is weak, it will make India's imports more expensive. It will make India's exports more attractive. When the rupee is strong, it will make imports cheaper, but exports are a little less competitive. For currency has a role to play in impacting commodity market prices. Weather, of course, is a no-brainer. All of us know so well how weather patterns, how monsoons and how rainfall impact agriculture production and agriculture productivity. We also have weather phenomena like El Nino and La Nina. La Nina is a weather phenomenon which we are experiencing this year in a very subtle fashion, which is what is bringing a lot more rain. El Nino phenomenon will actually mean dry conditions, etc. For weather, global weather is something we need to watch when we are in the commodity market. Government policies are also beginning to affect changes in import and export policy, changes in the tariff rates, customs duties, etc. Those also have to be watched. Last but not the least is funds, speculative funds. The pension funds and the hedge funds, mutual funds, they all have a big role to play in impacting commodity markets and commodity market prices. So those who are in the commodity markets ought to know the seven major drivers of commodity markets. And these drivers are quite dynamic. And therefore, what we talk today may not be relevant even tomorrow. For it, we need to dynamically track how these seven factors influence individual commodities and their prices and their demand and supply. Sorry. Next, very quickly, I don't want to steal the thunder of Sukrit in crude oil or Ali in palm oil or Archan in cotton, but because it is a fundamental forum, I just want to set the context for further discussion by our expert panelists. Use of energy actually fuels economic growth, and it is quite popularly said that crude oil is actually 90% politics, only 10% economics. And very interestingly, it was only yesterday that the OPEC celebrated its 60th birthday. Okay, 60 years ago, 14th of September, it was formed. What happens now? Currently, there is a fear of oversupply gripping the market. Just about in the last 1 week or so, there is a beginning of a sense of oversupply that the market might be facing. U.S. Production has increased, which was 12.4 million barrels a day in March, which collapsed to 10 million barrels a day in May. But it's from in August and September, it has started to pick up, and it's about 11 million barrels a day at the moment. Non-OPEC output is rising, which is obviously U.S. is one of the non-OPEC origins. And but the countries like Saudi Arabia, which have cut, Russia, for that matter, which have cut their production in terms of an agreement they entered into, are all finding it extremely difficult because they're facing fiscal challenges. They're not getting enough revenue to run their annual governmental programs, and therefore there is a rethink about the output cut agreement itself. If the agreement were to fall apart, I think it'll take the market in a very, very different direction. Come to India very, very quickly. Sorry. We are the world's third largest importer and consumer after, of course, the United States and China. We are facing our demand has weakened substantially. All of us know from March because of lockdown, etc. The demand for energy products has weakened. There's no travel, there's no commute. And therefore, August fuel demand was down 7.5% month on month. And at 4.4 million tons, it was 16% lower than a year ago. Look at diesel demand in India. Again, absolutely weak. 12% down month on month in August. And at 4.85 million tons, it's one-fifth lower than a year ago. Obviously, all this is the effect of COVID. All this is the effect of very weak economic activity and therefore weak fuel consumption. Let me come to cotton. These are data from the International Cotton Advisory Committee in Washington, D.C. You can see very clearly vis-a-vis 2019-20. In 2021, cotton output globally is going to decline. These are in tons. These are in metric tons. If you want to convert them into barrels of 170 kilograms, it just multiply by 6, very approximately. As a lower output of cotton in 2021, consumption had declined last year. It's going to slightly improve, but not go to pre-COVID levels anyway. Therefore, the ending stocks this year are going to be quite burdensome. They have been burdensome in the last 2 or 3 years. They're going to get more, they're going to get heavier this year. For economic uncertainty plus rising stocks, in my view, are going to put pressure on global cotton prices, which will obviously affect, which will also have an impact on India because of integration of our domestic market with the global market. The situation is quite dynamic. The Indian cotton situation is again we are facing a record area of 129 lakh hectares. Planting 12.9 million hectares. Output target fixed by the Agriculture Ministry is 36 million bales of cotton. Last year's output has been progressively raised, and the last number stands at 35.5 million bales. There are people who are saying it may not be even 36 million, it could even be 37 million bales this year, the harvest, which is now, we are waiting for it. But there is demand destruction due to pandemic. The kind of demand loss that we saw during April, May, June is now, of course, beginning to pick up, which is a good silver lining. But when will demand return to normal situation, pre-COVID situation? We don't know. At least I don't know. I'm sure experts will tell us. But burdensome stocks are expected this year in India, with the Cotton Corporation carrying large stocks and the private sector carrying large stocks, and then a slightly higher production. Vegetable oil, again, global production according to the US Department of Agriculture, major veg oils will be 209.7 million tons, which is up by 2.7 million tons from last year, of which palm oil will be about 75 million tons, and palm oil consumption will slightly trail palm oil production according to USDA estimate. Therefore, we have higher production of vegetable oil this year by 2.7 million tons, higher production of palm oil, but consumption will slightly trail palm oil production. And therefore, the drivers of palm oil, this is my last slide. Palm oil market drivers, obviously, one is the crude oil market. If crude oil prices start to rise, then it has a rub-off effect on palm oil, because then there'll be greater diversion of palm oil for biodiesel purposes, particularly a country like Indonesia has a very large, given a mandate this year their actual consumption is certainly going to trail the target that they have fixed. The price differential with soft oils like soybean oil and sunflower oil and rapeseed oil definitely impacts the palm oil prices. Larger the differential, the demand for palm oil increases, but narrower the differential, demand for soft oil goes up and demand for palm oil comes down. But palm oil globally is facing multiple challenges in terms of activists attacking it for on ecological and environmental issues, etc. Think, well, let's not go into that. China is a big factor. China imported a lot of palm oil last year because of their African swine fever problem. But this year that problem is contained, and therefore they will import, I believe, more soybean and less palm oil this year, which will obviously have an impact on palm oil market. And finally, of course, India's Atmanirbhar goal of becoming self-reliant. We import more than 14 million tons of vegetable oils every year, of which palm oil is about 9 million tons. But this year, because of demand destruction, my own estimate is that our imports will be of palm oil will be at least 1.5 million tons lower. For all these factors are going to play on the palm oil market, cotton market, crude oil market, etc., etc. Therefore, this is a context which I wanted to set. Let me say good luck. God bless you all. I'm going to be around as a moderator, and there could be follow-up questions. And now I'll invite our friend Sukrit to share his thoughts on the crude oil market. Where is the market headed, Sukrit? I need to stop sharing, right?
Yeah, you need to stop sharing.
I've stopped it.
You have done it. Thanks. Thanks,
Ma. Yeah. Okay. So, hi, friends. Actually, Chandra has done a great job by giving you figures and facts. Okay, which leaves me free to talk about feelings and where things are likely to go. More by seeing what is happening around you, because really speaking, this action has been virtually. It is unprecedented. We have not seen anything like this before. So let me just quickly, can you see my screen?
Yes, Mr. Sukrit.
Okay, fine. So, one second. So in the last 12 years, we are looking at the third price collapse. First was in 2008-2009 when it crashed from 144 to $30. Second was somewhere around 2015-2016, where again Jan 2016 again it reached close to $30. And most recent one, we had this historical phenomenon of WTI trading at a negative price. The negative price had nothing to do with the supply and demand of oil. It had more to do with the storage of oil on a given date, really. But anyway, it was history being made. So while the recovery from the first two was good and almost to, the first one was almost to similar levels, crude went up to as high as 110, 112 before it experienced a second collapse. This time it went to $85 or thereabouts before coming back down again. But what is different this time? This time, the last two drops were largely, you know, in the sense it seemed to be financial. As a player in the crude oil procurement and refining business, I kept on telling all kinds of people at those times that whenever crude prices went high, we never had any issue finding oil when we needed it. So it was not shortage of supply which drove those prices down, up or down. It was the extraneous factor. This time we've got a drop in demand, which is caused by a humanitarian crisis. I mean, this is a rare situation where we see all of us without masks. But how many of us really go out as regularly as we used to? Or even if, say, someone tells you 3 months down the line, we found a cure for COVID, how long will it be before you decide, oh, let's go to a restaurant and eat, or let's go for a holiday to, say, Goa or the backwater? Now, those things are going to change slightly. So a quick look at prices during 2020. You had prices drop at the start of the COVID scare to around $20 a barrel. Then came the infamous storage crisis where you saw it dip to sub 20. All this is Brent. WTI is something that does not really affect us as much as Brent does. So my focus tends to be on Brent. Then again, the OPEC cut prices, cut production, and we saw a rapid, note the rapidness. I'll touch on this rapid rise in prices earlier. Back to around $40 a barrel. From there, it went up to 45. And then at the start of September, it kind of gave up. And even having given up, it is still fighting valiantly above, just to stay just above $40 a barrel. These are daily prices where you can see it hung around $45, and you can see some technical lines here, but we will not go too much into the technicalities, except that it has breached a 100-day moving average of $40 just towards the end of last week. And that might be a critical point for price trackers and traders, that $40 may well be the next resistance rather than, you know, any rapid rise above 40. But let's go back to a field now. So from April, crude prices were rising largely due to OPEC production cuts and hopes of demand recovery. You know, people said, ki, we've been under lockdown so long, we will, let's lift lockdown. And, you know, you can't keep things locking down. You can't keep the economy at stagnation and so on and so forth. But every attempt to lift lockdown has been met with a dramatic rise in COVID-19 cases and an uptick in the number of deaths. I have been tracking more the number of active cases rather than the number of total cases or the number of total deaths. The active cases is now currently around 7.2 million odd, and it tends to drop and rise. So it would fall in line with our thought process. You know, every time you start opening up, COVID cases will rise. I mean, for those of us who are from Bombay, we know that not much is can be expected to happen until locals are let open for public. And how many of us actually relish the idea of letting our close family travel in those locals? Just think about it. Would you like, if you are my age, would you like your children to travel in the local? If you are a young professional, would you like your parents to travel in those locals? Would you like your siblings to travel in those locals? Somewhere in between, would you like your school and college going children to travel in those locals? Not going to do that. And that is a key factor in where oil supply demand is going to go. As Chandra said, it is all this has to do with economic growth and thought processes. So this is going to change how the world behaves over the next few years and going to have an impact on that. As I said, over the last fortnight, the market gave up on such hopes, and we've dropped around for 15%. But the price seems to be holding at around $40 a barrel. And it seems to be supported. I'll just stop for a few seconds and dwell on why this is happening. There are any number of reasons that people can give. But the few bullish factors is that first of all, this OPEC and non-OPEC producers continue to maintain production quota. And every time prices have dropped, they keep on raising the quota production bogey, so to speak. We will cut production, and almost each time the prices have responded. Well, to some extent, maybe less, maybe more, but they respond. Okay, so, and the belief is that if prices fall substantially below here, OPEC will not hesitate to cut again. Yeah. The second thing is a fundamental belief that, boss, we are going to overcome this. If we can't overcome this, then all this whole conversation that we are having about where prices will go and all is meaningless. In the end, we are all dead. Okay. The third reason is there's still too much cash in the market, and that is why the inefficient producers and refiners are being allowed to continue in the market. Banks have no choice but to go on trying to restructure loans, prevent companies from dying. So they're there. Hamara kya jata hai? We will stick around. If you cut down, you had QE2, QE3, QE4. If you cut back finances or something, everyone will get ruined. So in order, the system is too big to fail. We can't let big companies fail. So you let them go on, no matter what their inefficiencies are. Let's look at a few bearish factors. This thing about recovery from COVID, does anybody know? Earlier I mentioned about how are we going to go back to trains. We all keep on talking about vaccines. Everyone, Russia is saying first vaccine, India is saying they will fast track vaccines, reduce stringency on trials so as to allow vaccines to be tested. But who knows whether those vaccines will be effective. I was talking to a friend of mine who works with the Virology Institute in Hyderabad. So he said there are so many factors related to a vaccine. There is age, there is color, there is sex, there is religion, there is economic strata, there is climatic factors. And really, it would be around 10 years before you say a vaccine is successful or standard. But yet our sense of hope is so bad that anything, we will clutch at straws to hope for a recovery, because really we don't have too much left other than hope. Something will happen, something will happen. And that is what we are clutching at, is the sense. I'm not, please don't get me wrong, I'm not debunking people who are thinking like that. You have to think positively in this kind of situation, because otherwise you will die of depression rather than COVID. You can pick your choice. Neither is particularly palatable. So let's hope for the best and hope the first vaccine is active. As I said, efficacy will take some time to prove, but again, we will overcome. Let's believe on that. Now take a look at what will happen to pre-COVID. Will we revert to pre-COVID days? Now, I will draw from my personal life. As a passion, I play this game called Bridge. And we travel all around the country to play tournaments. Now, Bridge is a dying game, and the average age of the player is somewhere between 50 and 60. There are a lot of septuagenarians, a few octogenarians too. For them, travel is difficult. Health is always an issue. Hotel ka khana is a major problem. Now, with this COVID scare, who is going to let their parents travel? Who is going to let their family travel? That is not going to happen. Now again, people like us, we have resorted to playing the game online. And the number of people in the 60s, 70s and 80s who have actually figured out how to play this game online has increased vastly over the last 6 months. Almost anybody I know can go and play bridge online, which is some 10,000 people in a very small field. But in bigger fields, I'm sure we are not something, you know, unique that is happening. So the same thing is happening. So if I can do things online more efficiently, why will I take the trouble of getting into a wheelchair to go to the aircraft, then risking a fall? Who knows kya khana milega wahan par? I might as well do things.
Sukrit, so in a simple language, you want to believe that travel will substantially reduce.
Oh yes, it will.
One second, which in turn will have impact on crude oil consumption or energy.
Absolutely.
Consumption. Right. Okay.
Diesel and jet will really
right.
suffer.
Right.
Gasoline
okay.
not so much, because at least you'll go
right.
around your
right.
area in
right.
in
right.
your car.
That's right. Yeah? Very nice. I understand. So if you don't mind, conclude this round in about 2 minutes. And there will be a follow-up questions also. Yeah,
sure. So eventually, product demand will mean more than crude supply, because right now you know that there is shale. You know that OPEC has so much spare capacity.
Correct.
So crude supply is not really a factor. How will product demand grow? And I've given you a scenario of product demand taking some time to grow. So what is your short-term outlook? So optimistically, you can say that, you know, we find some miracle cure to COVID and we will go back to around 50 to 60.
Sukrit, let us not discuss prices. I want you to remove this slide if you don't mind. One sec, please. Yeah, it is important. But you just give a direction of the market rather than price. Because MCX is an exchange, and an exchange should not be discussing prices. Sorry,
okay,
I didn't alert you. My apologies.
Fine.
Maybe I should have alerted you in advance, but I'm now alerting both Arshan and Ali about this. We won't discuss, we may discuss price direction, but not price target as such. Yeah, okay.
These are not targets.
Fair enough. So these are trading ranges. Okay, all right.
Understood. And it's $10 higher away from
right.
today. And you know,
right.
it's funny, but the current trough could help push prices back there, because these low prices will lead to reduced investment and could lead to shortages tomorrow.
Right.
Okay. Pessimistically or actually even realistically, it may take longer to achieve this.
Correct.
In the longer term, the challenges are greater. As I said, the availability of supply, there is so much oil is coming out of people's ears. The other thing that is happening is sensitivity to nature, looking at your carbon footprint, etc., might work in terms of demand for hydrocarbons peaking. I mean, people have various dates, but it is something like the Kodak film, you know, we used to say that Kodak, one day suddenly it went out of fashion and it plummeted. So I don't know when this will happen, but this could well happen to crude oil itself, because there is a pressure for clean energy sources. We are looking at wind, we're looking at solar, we're looking at hydrogen, and our own PSUs, I think IOC set up one hydrogen fueling plant somewhere in Maharashtra, if I remember right.
And Sukrit, more important, electric vehicles.
Exactly.
Okay. My request is please wind up in a minute's time, please.
It is more or less done right now.
Yeah. Okay. Great. Oh, you've said it. You've said electric vehicles. Yeah.
Yeah. So the only bright spot looks like pet chem that could push it forward.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm more or less at the end.
No, perfect, perfect.
I will share this with you. You can contact me.
Yeah, right. So, thank you, Sukrit. I think very interesting. You have a short-term outlook and then you have a long-term outlook. Obviously, in the long term, certainly demand and consumption demand for fossil fuels as a complex is certainly going to reduce. We can see that happening in coal, and it's only a matter of time before it happens in crude oil. There's no doubt at all. Possibly gas will survive longer is my impression, but anyway, thank you very much. Thanks, Sukrit. There could be follow-up questions, and then we'll also have a Q&A session at the end of all the presentations. I'm now going to invite Archan Barua from Kargil, Delhi. He's going to share with us his thoughts on the cotton market fundamentals and outlook. Archan, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. So thank you, Mr. Chandrasekhar, and thank you everybody for organizing this. I was listening to the previous speaker, and as you said, there are no price forecasts in my presentation.
Very nice. Thanks.
Not because I was smarter, but simply because I don't know where the price is going.
I
didn't want to wager on that. But anyway, so what I will try and cover this in 10 minutes, which has been allotted to me, is basically the fundamentals. So I'll start with, how the global situation looks like, what has COVID done to us, and then I'll touch briefly upon India. And on the last slide, I will just leave one point or one indicator for the audience here that, how you can track cotton. Most of you are not from active cotton trading, but if you're looking at cotton out of interest or as an investment opportunity, I'll try and give you just one small indicator as to how you can track that. So if we start the global S&D, if you take the last 15 years, more or less the world has added more stocks. Production has been going up, consumption has been going up. But if we kind of break it down into two small segments, what has happened in the last 10 years? You see, in the last 10 years, production and consumption more or less have remained flat, or probably there has been a slight degrowth. But then if you come to the last 5 years, you will see production has grown at almost, a CAGR of about 4%, whereas consumption has basically remained flat. So in doing so, what has happened is year on year for 5 years now, the world will be adding more stocks. And if things are how it is predicted now, by July of 2021, we will have the second largest carry out in 15 years. The previous high was 2014-15, which was about 107 million bales. And this year we will probably reach about 104. But why am I showing this slide? 15 years of history, most of us, we don't identify with this. But what I would like to point out is just two things. If you see the last time when the world has had huge carry,
I'm not able to see your slide.
Is it?
Selby? Yeah.
You haven't shared it?
You have to share.
You haven't shared.
So let me know when you can, and then
Perfect. Okay.
Perfect.
Done. Go ahead.
So if you just look at this last 15 years, as I was saying, 10 years, basically no change in production, no change in consumption. Last 5 years, production has grown at 4%, consumption has basically remained flat. So what has happened? Every year for the last 5 years, we have added more and more stocks. But why are we showing this? What is it for people who are not from the cotton trade? Even 15 years ago, I was not in the trade. So how is it relevant for me today? What I would say is, the last time when the world reached 100 plus bales of carry out, million bales of carry out, the production was coming down. But at that time, we were in a period where consumption was expanding. So even though you had huge stocks, you had a growing consumption, and the consumption was able to eat into the stocks quicker. It is a little different this time. even though situation is better today than what it was, I would say, in March or in January of 2000 this year, we are not going to be growing at that same pace, and we will definitely not come back to the pre-COVID consumption by the end of this particular season. The second point I want to make is, if you see the volatility of the green and blue lines, the green line is consumption, is production, and the blue line is consumption. As Mr. Chandrasekhar said, cotton is supposed to be a growth commodity. But my experience tells me, you know, just looking at numbers, that production reacts very quickly to prices. Consumption does not. The kind of destruction that we have had in the last 6 months, it is not going to come back in the next 6 months. We will definitely improve. But I don't know whether it will take 12 months or 18 months or 24 months for us to come back at the growth pace where we were in November of 2019. So even though you have a huge stocks, my point is, given the behavior aspect of consumption, you will not be able to consume it as quickly as one should. Okay. So just moving on, how has hard has been this COVID? You know, this is basically USDA's month on month projection of production, consumption, and the ending stocks. The green line again is the production and the blue line is consumption. Just look at how hard the consumption was. In November, we were projecting that there will be about, let's talk about units, 80 million units of cotton that was carry out, that was going to be the ending stocks. In September, we are talking about almost 100. So this is 20 million bales that of carry out that is left at the end of this season, which ended on July. And just to give you a perspective, this 20 million bales is more than 2 months of consumption. So this is last year. How has the projection changed for the coming year? It starts on the cotton season starts from 1st of August. So we are in the new season. And then it ends on 31st of July, 2021. So how has the new season projection changed? If you see May, when we were in the middle of the lockdown, except for China, rest of the world was all in lockdown. From then, we have continuously added stocks. So even though we have come out of the lockdown, the consumption has actually taken a beating. So how does the Indian S&D look like? Again, I'm kind of just giving you very high numbers. Production continues to grow. The way Mr. Chandrasekhar was telling you, the acreages, the yield, the fantastic monsoon that we are having this year, we are headed towards another record crop. It may not be the highest ever, but it could be very close to the highest ever crop. I'm sorry if my slides have moved. However, on the consumption side, we are coming back. If, you know, he made a point as to at what capacity the industry is running. This is again a private estimate, one man's estimate. So I would say my estimate is our consumption went down to something like 10-15% when we were in the peak of the lockdown. From 100% in, you know, March, we went down to 10%. And even today we are somewhere around 80-85%. It will probably be quarter one before we hit back to the 100% consumption that the textile industry was running at. So for the last 6 years, every year India has produced more than what it consumes. This is important for India because we are a surplus balance sheet. We produce more cotton than what we consume. On top of that, we have a farmer support system called minimum support price, which every year increases. Now, the one single takeaway from this particular chart is you look at the green and the red bars. The red and the yellow bars. The yellow bars are the private stocks. Every year, end of the season, the private trade in India, which is, you know, traders, your processors, your spinning mills, all of them carry about 8 to 9 million bales, more or less. But last 2 years, look at the red bar, which is the Cotton Corporation of India. It's the government body who, in order to support the farmer, buys the cotton and then, you know, they buy at a fixed price and then they sell it later on. Look at how the role of CCI has become unprecedented in the last two seasons. They are the ones who will be carrying between 9 to 10 million bales this season and in the next season, which is almost possibly half of the total carryout. So they are acting as the shock absorbers for all this excess production, or you would say the demand destruction, which is happening. And because there is one single body in the country who will you know, own 50% of the stocks, they are the one who are going to decide the prices in the country. So this is kind of not the exact free market that we were talking about. Now, if we go to the global level, so what is happening globally? Again, on the left side is your 2019-20, the season that went by. And on the right is your 2020-21, the season that we have started from 1st of August. So your free stocks are definitely growing. We have seen that year on year, we are adding stocks. But look at the breakdown. 25% of the ending stocks in both the years will be with government hands. So in India, it will be the Cotton Corporation of India. In China, it will be with the Chinese Reserve. And in US, it will be with the US government under this farm loan program. Now, what does this mean? This means that India, China, and US have programs in place where the farmer has the incentive to keep growing. They get the positive signal that, you know, you keep growing, we are there to support you. And in case you produce more than what we require, the government will absorb it. But what it also means is that there are countries like Brazil and Australia and West Africa where there are no farmer support system, which means those guys will have to compete and will be under pressure to sell their stocks. They all are producing more year on year. So most likely the world trade will be driven by countries like Brazil, who will be the price leaders, West Africa. Australia is a small producer, but they produce very high quality cotton. So they also, to some extent, will determine the prices. US, because of all this US-China trade deal, will most likely have a natural demand in China. I would call it an artificial demand because China is buying US cotton under an obligation, not because of economics. So US cotton will possibly be taken care of. And in India, the surplus will be absorbed by CCI, but the Indian trade is most likely to be a price taker. We will be the last people to sell the cotton, and we will be basically have to take the price of the residual demand which is left. Now, for those of you who are unfamiliar with what ICE is, this is Intercontinental Exchange. This is the most trusted and single most important futures exchange. In India, we have MCX, which is for the Indian cotton, but the rest of the world trades on ICE. Now, this is the last, I would say, I especially took January 2008 because it was prior to the Lehman Brothers crisis. This is from January 2008 till September 2020, so almost about 13 years of how ICE has behaved. Now, if you look at that, this year we have unprecedented carry out. As I had showed in the previous slides, 2019 and 2020 season, the carry out is almost close to 95-96%, which means for one whole year, if the world doesn't grow cotton, there is still enough cotton in the world. So the last time when the carry out was this high, it was about 90% plus during 2013-14 and 14-15 seasons, two seasons in a row. At that time, ICE traded in
I think we have lost Mr. Archan. Yeah, I think you're back.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. Yeah, please continue.
Okay. Yeah, so what I was trying to tell you is that we have had previous years where the carryout has been this high, 2013-14.
Hello, I think he is having unstable internet connectivity.
Hello.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay, I'll just carry on. Yeah, I'll just carry on. I'm not audible. Let me know.
Yeah.
So this is how ICE has been. And the market at that time dropped from 83 to about 57 with an average of about 63. Now, I'm not giving you a price idea that will be at 63. And I'll come to the next slide why. So from here, do we see the market as bullish or bearish? I don't know, as I said. What so far I have shared with you is the fundamentals. The fundamentals tell you that globally, we have the record ending stocks. Fundamental tell you that India, we have record ending stocks. It tells you that India is going to be the last bale in the world and we will compete for the residual demand at whatever price is being offered to us. We will not command the price. So far, so good. But does this mean that it will remain bearish from here? I don't know. What you need to take into account is something known as managed money, which Mr. Chandrasekhar covered in his slide. I think he has spoken in details than what I would want to share. But just so that you know, this graph on the left shows you what has been the the average position taken by the managed money. The managed money are your speculators. They are some of your swap dealers. They are the people who come in and out of the market because they either believe the price is cheap or the price is too high. And the bottom of the graph, the one which is negative, is the trade. That's the merchants like us. We are generally always short on the exchange because we are long cotton, so we hedge it on the exchange. What I would point here is, as Mr. Chandrasekhar and the speakers before me have said, is there is enough of cheap, free money in the world. What do you do with this money? You cannot invest in real estate. You cannot consume more. You cannot spend more. The only place people think they can do is, invest in stocks and commodities. The specs have showed very clearly that when cotton goes to 60 cents, even probably a little higher than that, they are happy to increase their position there. So that is a kind of non-fundamental support that the market is getting so far. It doesn't mean that they will always keep buying. You please bear this in mind. Tomorrow, if they believe that the world is ending, they will sell this down to wherever they can. But as of now, over the last 3 months, we are seeing that they are providing a support to the market at 60, 61 kind of a level. People are investing in commodities as an asset class. You also need to take into consideration your competition from crude. Crude is the raw material for man-made fiber, which competes with cotton. As crude becomes cheaper, your synthetics become cheaper. All the dry fit that you use today is non-cotton. So if that becomes cheaper, people will start moving away from cotton and produce more, I would say, man-made fiber garments. And then you have the weaker dollar. As more dollars are getting printed, in the short term, dollar is weaker. The weaker dollar generally translates into a higher commodity price. And last of it are your trade deals and sanctions. So, China has this obligation to buy certain amount of agricultural goods from US. Cotton is one of the most important commodities in that. If China buys, it is a direct support to the US cotton prices, which is reflected on ICE. At the same time, of late, there are now sanctions that US has put on China on the Xinjiang province. Any cotton which is arising out of Western China, they don't want the retailers to use it because of humanitarian issues, etc. What has happened? China has in response issued a 400,000 tons of processing quota, which means the Chinese mills will now import cotton from rest of the world, make the garments and export it back. So this is a way to fight the sanction. China stands up and says, we are not using our cotton, we are using your cotton. So our industry, you cannot ban our industry products. So those kind of, short-term disruptions, etc., will keep on happening. So this is the non-fundamental part of it. So I would leave you with this last slide, which I said is, for a non-cotton trader, how would you look at the cotton price? How will you make sense out of it? So if you see what I have tried to show you here is the prices between Indian MSP, which is your bar with the brown, dark brown color, then where the blue bar is where the Indian price needs to be relative to Brazil, US and West Africa. And the red line is your futures market, which is ICE. ICE is a kind of a proxy for the rest of the world cotton. So what you see is as the futures market goes up, the rest of the world prices, which is your yellow line of West Africa, your USA and your Brazil prices keep going up. As those prices go up, the ability of the world to pay a better price for India, which is reflected in the blue line, goes up. So the takeaway is if you have prices above 70 cents, then you see that the blue line and the brown line, which is the price that India can command in the world market, and MSP, they are either equal or the price is better than MSP. So if ICE stays above 70 cents, we expect demand to move to India, which means India's exports will increase. But at the same time, if the price drops below 60 cents, if it goes to 55, 57 type of level, you see that India's MSP price is higher than the rest of the world prices, which means Indian consumers will start importing cotton. So for somebody who wants to look, I would just give you this simple range at a 70 cents. Please expect Indian prices should naturally go up. At below 60 cents, Indian prices should start feeling the pressure because of competition from imports. So yeah, so that is where I would end this. And thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Chandrasekhar, just a minute. Kindly post all your feedback and queries in the chat section to all the participants, just a request. Thank you. Yes, Mr. Chandrasekhar.
Thank you, Archan, for this wonderful insight. I think you have covered. I wanted to ask you about exports, and I think I now understand what you're saying. It's very important. We now come to our next wonderful speaker, Ali from ITC Foods, is going to talk about palm oil. Ali, the floor is yours. Your take on the palm oil market fundamentals.
That's right. Thank you, sir, for the invitation, and I'll thank you for the IMC for the event as well. Before I start discussion on the palm fundamentals, I'll just take a minute on what is new normal right now. The COVID is something which is a new normal for everyone, and I've just plotted three events which were there in mankind, which you have witnessed a similar thing, but the impact of COVID is much higher vis-a-vis all of them.
Yeah.
And that is the reason. And unlike the previous coronavirus event, which are the SARS or MERS, the global lockdown, which wasn't prominent, and it is only prominent in terms of COVID. And with that context, I would like to start my presentation. And here we go with pandemics versus palmonomics. So the economic side of pandemic and economic side of palm oil, which I would like to discuss. It's just a quick one slide, which I've covered all the basic fundamentals, which are the drivers of the palm oil. Firstly, I would like to show the COVID cases vis-a-vis the palm oil prices. The prices dipped sharply when the COVID cases were low, whereas it has risen sharply when it has gone high. The cases have gone high, and the BMD is right now close to 3,000 ringgits. Well, is it irrational exuberance which is happening? We will just cover up in the later plots, which I'll be putting it across to you. So markets have seen a good upsurge. As Mr. Chandrasekhar has put it across, the good correlation between the Brent crude prices and the palm oil prices, especially in the case of events which are the global events, we see there's more closer relationship because market fundamentals are distorted and it's overtaken by something called as looking the market. The markets look beyond the fundamentals to look for the direction. And these are the key events which has been plotted out here and how the palm oil prices have moved vis-a-vis the Brent crude prices. Lastly, the weather, which has been the key factor in the month of Jan 2020, when the COVID cases started to rise, there was a fear of El Nino, which is coming in. And now we have entered September. Now it's like no El Nino, but La Nina. So El Nino is very bad for the palm production cycle, whereas La Nina is very supportive because good rains leads to good productivity, but later part of the year. So there's always a lag effect on the production front, which is obviously, in case of palm, it's always 3 to 6 months down the lane. Looking at the palm production in Malaysia, even though due to COVID, we have witnessed a huge cry of, the markets are witnessing a labor shortage, production is getting impacted, harvest is getting impacted. However, if you see the production numbers from Malaysia, month on month, if I see the numbers have been rising, even though the labor shortage has been there, Malaysia production trend has been on an upsurge. So is it really a huge outcry which the markets are making out of it to corner its side, or is it the factual thing? As for the fundamentals, I would see the markets are seeing a good upsurge in the productivity. Coming to the supply side, wherein both India and China, which are the key consumers of palm oil, approximately 40% of their consumption of palm is towards the out-of-home consumption, which is HoReCa markets. And during the time of COVID, as everyone knows that the out-of-home consumption for every one of us in India especially has been completely downslided. And still the markets are trending higher. We have seen the market stocks of Indian edible oils leaped quite sharply in month of April, May. Now it started to recover. But in case of palm, the demand destruction is still prevalent because People prefer more of a soft oils when it comes to in at home consumption, whereas it comes to out of home consumption, it's always a palm. So palm dominance as such is expected to reduce in India. We would see some amount of demand destruction, which is already there in place. Linking the same to China as well. China has been, piling up huge amount of soybean, especially in case of Brazil and now in case of US. Last year, I would say palm had, at a respite because of in US-China trade war. Had it not been the case, palm prices would have been, holding as high, which was reported last year. And this year, it is only COVID which has been supporting the prices. Fundamentally, I would say the markets are very much, have facing the irrational exuberance. And one more factor is the liquidity. The markets are primarily driven by the liquidity. We have seen a dollar index. We have seen the palm prices. So obviously, inverse correlation with the commodity markets. And with that thought, I would say the markets are reeling higher. We have seen the markets trending higher, and it could only lead to demand destruction. We are heading to a winter months during the OND period right now, and wherein the palm demand itself is lower. Even though India is heading for festivity, we have seen a good amount of buying happening and import numbers looking sufficiently higher. But OND, the winter demand would be lower for palm compared to other soft oils, and demand destructions could be underway. And obviously, the competition between the palm and the soft has negated. The palm has, in fact, almost reeling higher towards, compared to the soft oils, where soya bean and sun. And it has to discount itself to, attract the demand. With that remarks, I would, set the context for this pandanomics versus palmonomics, because time constraint, I can't divulge into much of that. Just before I conclude, there's a disclaimer. These views are shared by my sides, and also nowhere the company is accountable for the same. So with that, I conclude my presentation.
I love this. Thank you, Ali. I think as usual, very crisp and absolutely to the point. But tell me, I have a question for you actually. What is driven? We saw CPO prices closer to 3,000 ringgits last quarter of 2019. And at that time, I had said that in the first quarter of 2020, there will have to be correction. Little realizing that COVID will overtake, etc., all that. But right now, what is the trigger in the last 1 month that we have seen? Is crude palm, is Brent, a price rise in Brent is driving CPO prices, or is Indonesia's oil mandate really picking up very well? I doubt. I think it is trailing, or what kind of, or is there a combination of factors which is?
So I would say at present the markets of palm has really decoupled with the crude oil, okay, primarily because the upsurge in palm is much higher as compared to the crude oil.
Okay.
Secondly, as you rightly said, the Indonesian biodiesel policy. So as you know, it's Indonesian data is almost a black box, and considering the fact that biodiesel is almost 80% which is used in transport and 20% I would say which is used in the industry side, and if the restrictions are there in the movement of transportation due to COVID and lockdown, I would say the numbers which they have projected for the whole of 2020, I would say it would be really, really lower as compared to what is their expectation is.
Yeah.
So I think so. It's as I rightly said, sir. Last year it was China which supported the palm. This year it's a COVID. And I think so, with too much liquidity chasing, and it's just irrational exuberance which is driving the market. There's no connect with the fundamentals at present.
Thank you, Vedant. Thank you very much. I think we have one more young expert speaker from MCX, Rishi. Rishi Nantan is going to share with us his views about, obviously, risk management, commodity risk management. Rishi, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Chandrasekhar, and good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here in this event with IMC. I'd like to speak about agri-risk management and how the exchanges and the exchange ecosystem is helping in that. So first of all, what is the need for risk management? See, in India, we say ad nauseum and ad infinitum that we are one of the largest producers or consumers of many commodities, agri commodities in the world. However, the awareness for hedging is very low, and what to say of farmers and traders, but even listed companies are very reluctant to hedge. So, for example, a jeweler, his main business is the making charges on the jewelry, and he should not have anything to do with the price of gold, which should be completely hedged. However, if you see the awareness between in the jewelers is higher, but in the agri sector, whether it is a biscuit manufacturer or anyone else who's using agri inputs, I don't know to what extent they hedge. So the importance of hedging, and especially for farmers, I'd like to talk about. So risk management through commodity derivatives makes it very easy, because commodity derivatives not only provide a risk management platform for price, but also provide a delivery platform, because almost all the contracts are compulsory delivery contracts, which means that they'll culminate into delivery. Now, we've seen two experts speak about cotton and palm oil. So I would like to also say that Indian derivative markets offer contracts across various agricultural commodities, whether it be pulses, oil seeds, fibers, and other oils. So, you know, there is ample scope and opportunity for hedging. In cotton, if you see that the annual volatility in 2020, January to August, was 18%, which gives you, you know, that volatility is not a small amount of volatility. So it underscores the importance of hedging and price risk management. And the MCX cotton contract is unique, that it is based on the internationally accepted technical specifications of cotton. And in India also, around 75% of the cotton grown in the country would be eligible for the MCX cotton contract. So it is very inclusive, and MCX cotton has around 65 to 70% correlation with the international ICE cotton prices as well. So both in terms of delivery and price risk management, the MCX cotton contract is very apt for this. Another thing is about the crude palm oil contract, which has seen an annual volatility of around 22%, which again highlights the importance of people hedging their exposure. Plus, the advantage with the Indian cotton contract, the CPO contract, is that since it is rupee denominated, importers can hedge and they can also get a currency hedge because it is denominated in rupee. And this contract also has a 95% correlation with the Bursa Malaysia, which is the global benchmark for palm oil prices. Now, what are the advantages or the highlights why one should hedge, especially with farmers and other participants hedging on the exchanges? First is that the exchanges provide price signals. So, for example, a farmer who wants to, say, sow his crops, he can look at the three-month futures and then can take a decision based on the price there, whether what type of crop he should plant. So it gives you a price signal as to what the future beholds. Secondly, for a manufacturer or a consumer also, the futures prices give an indication of where the prices are headed, and they can also plan their production and consumption accordingly. So someone, as I said, gave an example of a biscuit manufacturer, they can hedge their inputs, various inputs, by looking at the future prices, including the palm oil prices. Now, another factor is that, say, for a farmer who is planting the crops, not only can he get a price signal, but he can also hedge his produce. So, for example, a farmer can buy, he can plant the crop and he can sell his produce in the futures. And once the crop is ready, he can deliver it on the exchange platform. The exchange provides the warehousing system and the complete infrastructure. And if the farmer does not have the wherewithal or the large size to cater to the exchange quantum, because the exchange has certain minimum quantity and of goods that can be delivered. So most farmers access the exchange ecosystem through the farmer producer organization or the FPOs. So these farmer collectives help farmers collect the produce and grade them, sort them, make them up to a certain standard, and thereafter deliver them on the exchange platform. Now, even for a producer or a manufacturer, it is beneficial because, as I said about the hedging. Now, another advantage for farmers is that apart from the futures, we also had options on goods, which is a new system which the regulator has allowed, in which the farmer can get the benefit of the upside without taking the risk on the downside. So for example, in a futures contract, the farmer, if he sells, say, for example, the price of his commodity is say 100 rupees, and if he sells it tomorrow after 3 months, if the price goes to 105, the farmer will still get 100, even though maybe his cost of production is 80. But his margin, his profit is capped at 100 because he sold the future at 100. On the other hand, if he buys a put option and then plants his crop, then he has the advantage that if he buys a 100 rupee put option, then he's assured that he'll get 100 rupees for his produce. But if the price rises to say 105 or 110, then that additional upside is also his. So this gives a unique advantage, these options on goods, to the farmers to actually hedge and protect the downside while ensuring that the entire upside is theirs for the taking. Now, these factors, another thing is if the farmers do early paying, or if anyone for that matter does early paying, there is no margins required to be paid for that produce. So overall, if we see that the need for hedging in the Indian economy is great, there are a lot of people and banks are lending. If you see, a lot of NPAs of banks would not have happened if the companies would have hedged, because all the commodity related NPAs that banks are seeing maybe is because of the extreme volatility in the prices of the commodities, due to which companies are also facing problems. And I see this as an example earlier, when I used to see balance sheets of pharma companies and software companies, where sometimes the operating profit and loss was lesser than the forex gain or loss. And I used to wonder why these companies don't hedge their forex gain or loss. Afterwards, when currency exchanges came in, maybe the companies have got more aware and are hedging their currency exposures. Similarly, it is very important for all market participants, whether it is corporates, farmers, individual traders, aratias, stockists, to hedge their produce or their stocks, because given that, they will be able to do their business on a normal way, and otherwise they will be exposed to the vagaries of the market. Either they will make supernormal profits or they will have huge losses, which is not advisable. So it is better that they take the hedging route and play safe. So as someone said, to err is human, but to hedge divine. So with these words, I'd like to stop here. Thank you.
Thanks, Rishi. I just love this, your last quote. To err is human, but to hedge is divine, is extremely important. And in a number of events in the last 10, 15 years, 20 years, I'm sure our Suresh Bhai Kotak is there, highly respected Bhishma Pitamaha of this commodity market. We have been together, and we would always say that hedging is not speculation. Not hedging is speculation. If you don't hedge your risk, you're actually speculating in the market. And then therefore, thank you very much for this. Any thoughts on your plans to attract more participants in both palm oil contract and cotton contract? Would you like to share some plans or thoughts that you have in mind, Rishi?
Yes. So we always aspire to get more and more participants on our platform, and we work very hard. So we've been working with a lot of FPOs, trying to do programs with them, with the industry, through the associations, and we reach out to various corporates. So the overall idea is to get more and more people on our exchange, because as our MD also said earlier, that make in India is not possible unless we have the pricing and trading power. So make in India will be complete only when we have price in India and trade in India. Because if you just manufacture without having pricing power, then if you have a bumper crop, you'll have to sell cheap. And if you have a shortage, then even if the price is good, what's the point? You don't have anything to sell. Okay. So the pricing power and the trading power should be with us. And that is what we are trying to achieve at MCX.
Excellent. I think I want to request each one of the panelists, if you have missed out on anything, let's have one round of just a minute or max 2 minutes. Any concluding remarks that you will have? I'll start with Sukrit. Sukrit, you want to add anything beyond what you had said?
Nothing really. I mean, somebody was wondering what my whole conversation had to do with all prices.
It's okay. Don't take. Observations will come.
I just like to say that oil is any commodity depends on supply and demand. Correct. You have to figure out what is going to affect demand over the next few years. And your lifestyle is going to change, which is why I was talking more about lifestyle than, what Saudi will do or what China will do, etc. This is the most important thing that is affecting us at this time.
I agree.
I was taking a different approach to it, actually.
Thanks. I think crude oil, I call that a universal intermediate. It drives almost everything. It drives economic growth. But when the prices rise too much, it also drives out growth. Because people tend to then spend more money in energy consumption itself. Anyway, so thanks. Archan, in anything else, anything you would like to add as a parting comment or something?
No, I mean, nothing in particular, but I would appreciate what MCX has been doing on the, domestic cotton futures market. I think they are at a stage where there is a lot more expectation from them to improve the contract, the liquidity and volumes, etc. there. So, we as market participants.
I'm sure that's...
I'm happy to take questions.
No, but I think that's a great input for Rishi and MCX. Very nice. Ali, Beta, anything, any comments, any...
So just want to say that what we have seen in GFC, which is global financial crisis, when the music stops, I don't know what's going to be the impact, because right now it's a mad rush account liquidity.
Yeah.
And it's all asset classes have, been chased by the liquidity. So if the music stops and the situation doesn't get to normal, I think so we are headed for something going to be worse in the global markets. I mean, I'm just saying on those lines.
Right.
Which is where hedging will be particularly useful.
Yeah, exactly. But while you are on this, when the music stops, what happens? Most of us have lived through this global financial crisis, 2008, 9, 10, Lehman Brothers, quantitative easing, and a whole lot of things. And what happened to gold? Gold prices started to rise from the year 2000 until the end of 2012 and the first quarter of 2013. Double-digit growth year on year, simply liquidity-driven commodity boom. That's nothing right. More. And it got worse, went to $1,800, $1,900, etc. And what happened on 14th April 2013? Look at the record. A huge collapse, because that is a day the market got a signal that the US Fed is going to start tightening, start raising interest rate, and they will start buying back the bonds, etc. So, but I am thinking this in this pandemic, countries have already contracted for a huge amount of debt, number one. central banks have dropped interest rate like never before. In some cases, it is negative interest rate. Third one, extraordinary amount of liquidity in the market, which some people estimate at $15 trillion printing of notes. But this time, given the fact that this pandemic is not going to go away so easily, maybe another five quarters, we don't know. The possibility of this ultra accommodative monetary policy continuing till end of 2021, possibly into 2022, is very real. And therefore, jab tak there is this kind of mad liquidity and dollars available at dirt cheap rates, don't expect any major collapse in commodity prices is what I would think. Thank you very much.
So last is the what will the US elections shaping up like?
Absolutely, it will make a big difference.
That's right.
Trump or Joe Biden will yeah. definitely make a difference. Thanks. I think it is very wonderful. Rishi, anything else to add in a minute or two?
Yeah, so I just say that this global volatility and where a tweet can change your world overnight, it is more important to hedge the geopolitical tensions, global uncertainty, flood of easy money into the economy where people are chasing assets just to ensure that the value of the money is kept stable, because otherwise if they stay in cash, then the value of money is eroding. So these things make hedging all the more important and all the more imperative.
Right. So there, again, just to go back to that statement, hedging is not speculation. Not hedging is speculation. That is the point. Thank you. Thanks very much. I think we have done 4 o'clock now. It's 5:45. We need to. I don't find in the chat any major questions. I'm thinking when there are no questions, I assume that all our expert speakers have left no one in any doubt. You've cleared all their doubts and given them what is required to be shared with them. And then therefore, I think we should now conclude this webinar. Before I hand over to our senior Tanil Bhai Kilachan, I want to from my side, and I want to thank Sukrit, I want to thank Archan, I want to thank Ali Mohammed, and of course our friend P.S. Reddy and Rishi from MCX, and our vice chairman Mr. Khurakiwala, and of course Selby for so well anchoring all this. Thank you very much. Good luck. God bless you all. Tanil Bhai, for the formal vote of thanks.
Thank you for that wonderful panel discussion. We request all the participants to kindly post their feedbacks in the chat section, which will guide and enable us to improve and bring better seminars for you. As we come to the end of the session, may I request Mr. Tanil Kilachan, co-chairman IMC ERTF, to present the vote of thanks. Mr. Tanil Kilachan? Mr. Kilachan? He is disconnected. Yeah.
Okay. I think it's okay. So on behalf of IMC Chamber of Commerce, the President, Vice President, and Mr. Kilachan, who is the co-chair of the ERTF, I want to thank all the panelists, my co-panelists, and all the participants. I think it touched, it went close to 100 is what I saw some time ago. I hope you found it useful. Send us your feedback. I want to request all the participants to send their feedback to us. And therefore, we hope we will bring to you similar, really enriching events about markets, particularly commodity markets. And with this, we will conclude this webinar. And let me from my side say again, good luck and God bless you all. Stay safe.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you.